On October 27th, I used an Amazon voucher to spend €681 on the DJI Pocket 3. And the very next day, I spent €70 on the PNJ Pocket, which boasts superior face tracking. I had to redo the tests 5 times to be sure, but... Before you comment below this video, yes, I know it's a specific situation, a challenging test where you walk around a pillar, turn your back, then face the camera again. But here's the catch. The cheaper PNJ Pocket catches up, but the DJI Pocket 3 doesn't. Wasn't the DJI Pocket 3 supposed to have flawless face tracking with its brand new Active Track 6.0? The PNJ Pocket is a simpler pocket gimbal camera without a joystick. It offers follow modes typical of gimbal cameras, records in selfie or standard mode, and supports both smooth and fast tracking. You can use it for photos, videos, time lapses, and slow motion, and it offers resolutions up to 4K 30. The video quality is good, but mainly in straightforward recording scenarios. It performs well when there's not too much contrast between the subject and the background, also known as limited dynamic range. In such situations, it captures very good footage, slightly inferior to more expensive cameras, though the difference is hardly noticeable. However, in bright sunlight, its limitations become evident. The sensor struggles with very bright highlights, often overexposing them, such as when your face is in direct sunlight. It seems that PNJ is aware of this issue, as the camera tends to underexpose scenes where the background is much brighter than the subject, like when you're filmed with bright light or the sky behind you, resulting in a darker appearance of your face. You have just witnessed the striking difference with the DJI Pocket 3 in handling a difficult scenario. You may think it's an unfair comparison, but I wanted to provoke you, to make you aware of another major issue with the PNJ Pocket. The automatic white balance was unreliable during all my tests, even shifting noticeably within the same scene. It's better to use it in manual mode, which works well. It's a shame for such a good, budget-friendly gimbal camera that has a lot to offer for the price. It even comes with a simplistic smartphone app, I admit, but it's enhanced by a simplified Wi-Fi connection through a custom-made QR code. €201.85, another great deal for us, for a gimbal camera with a detachable head. It has a 90 centimeters, 35 inches cord that allows for versatile camera usage. I spent an additional €15 for a FeiyuTech case with an extension pole, enabling me to record some creative footage. Guys, this gimbal camera really is a steal. It's excellently engineered, and the menu itself shows the extent of care taken to optimize your experience. You can specify how you've mounted the camera, like as a normal pocket gimbal with the camera on top, or if it's detached, or even if you're using an underwater case. There are stabilization algorithms for specific scenarios, like recording motorcycle footage in a car or while running. Normal and fast follow modes are available, which I always use, but you'll truly appreciate the computational power when exploring the different recording modes. The FeiyuTech Pocket 2 can capture footage up to 4K at 60 frames per second. Unfortunately, it falls short in advanced intelligent assisted modes. For example, there's no face-oriented exposure. If the background is much brighter than the subject, the camera only adjusts the brightness when the subject occupies most of the frame. Here, the DJI Pocket 3 clearly has the upper hand. However, high-quality and professional modes are available, offering the more experienced users the ability to customize the recording settings. I really like the FeiyuTech Pocket 2S as a pocket gimbal camera, but my 100% honest review must highlight 4 aspects that are somewhat lacking. First, the face tracking is perhaps the weakest among the gimbal cameras I've tested. Second, the auto white balance does an adequate job, but it doesn't compare to the DJI Pocket series. Third, the detachable camera head initially excited me about the possibilities for dynamic shooting, like in unboxing videos where I could swiftly change the camera position thanks to the magnetic mount. However, the minimum focus distance is frustratingly short. The fixed focus lens doesn't deliver in terms of sharpness, especially noticeable when subjects are within the 30 centimeters, about 12 inches, minimum focus distance, leading to overly blurry footage that's essentially unusable. This major limitation stems from two crucial design choices, the fixed focus and the lens design optimized for more distant subjects. The FeiyuTech Pocket 2S is a really nice pocket camera gimbal, featuring a design that stands out as creative and innovative in the market. It offers plenty of recording options, but seems more tailored for creative users than those focused primarily on quality. The DJI Pocket 2 has just two minor drawbacks while delivering very good and consistent quality across all aspects of video recording. There are plenty of tests out there in the wild where everyone can tube for you to see, but I want to highlight that DJI recently addressed one of the three original major weaknesses. The updated DJI Mimo app no longer drops the signal every few seconds and at a short distance from the Pocket 2. This used to drive me crazy. I would go on location, start recording, and then spend part of my day restarting the DJI Mimo app. We finally have a reliable connection between the camera and the smartphone. It's not on the level of DJI's professional wireless video transmitters, but now, at about 3 or 4 meters, the video stream might experience some frame dropping. Yet the connection doesn't cut off and becomes smooth again as the smartphone gets closer to the DJI Pocket. So, a nearly perfect pocket camera. Almost, but not quite. Due to the overheating issue, which remains a significant concern for DJI products, as seen recently with the DJI Osmo Action 4, especially for those hoping to use the camera in the summer for more than 20 minutes under the blazing sun. But use it in moderate climates, don't rely too heavily on the less-than-stellar face tracking, and you'll have a great gimbal camera. And now, as it's finally the older generation, just check eBay and grab one for around 200 euro. It's almost a steal. I feel like the real leap forward with the DJI Pocket 3 isn't being emphasized enough. The size of its sensor is remarkable. I really appreciate the wide range of frame rates, as well as the variety of resolutions available, especially the 1:1 aspect ratio. But what truly stands out is the sensor size. It's much larger than the competition, giving us a pocket gimbal camera that can blur the background. Just look at these two clips. The foliage first and the building later are out of focus. This enhancement greatly improves our videos, because by creating a separation between the speaking subject in the foreground and the background, the audience will subconsciously be more inclined to focus on the subject. What were you focusing on, the speaker or the people around him? And now? Isn't it easier to concentrate on the subject with a strong bulk effect? Even better with a slight camera movement, isn't it? But that's a topic for another episode. Beware! Unintentional out-of-focus can be a major issue. If you have a sensor capable of blurring things, the last thing you want is a blurred subject. To counter this, DJI introduced full-pixel autofocus. Take a look at this Sony demo comparing full-pixel autofocus with the now outdated phase detection technology. Did you see how effectively the camera focuses in both low-light and low-contrast scenes? Let's talk negatives now. The new dynamic framing in DJI Pocket 3 requires the subject to be in one of the predetermined spots for framing, which it often loses track of. Active Track 6.0 falls short of expectations, hopes, and advertising promises. Currently, it's not DJI but Hohem that holds the lead in advanced auto-tracking technology, thanks to their AI sensors, and they're just so easy to use. Just connect it, make the framing gesture to the camera, choose a new spot in the frame, and voila, the Hohem tracking will never lose you. Shame on you, DJI. Just kidding, the face tracking isn't that terrible, especially if we're close to the camera. So, about the positives, DJI Pocket 3 features the same DLOGM 10-bit picture profile we already loved in the DJI Action 4. It offers an extended dynamic range, good color balance in images, and is so easy to grade in post-production. No, really, you don't have to be a colorist to get good results. Let's wrap up with a note on something that's not perfect, but improvable. Focus breathing. I did push the camera to its limits intentionally, but despite the full-pixel autofocus technology, it can still happen. It might be nice to have the option to adjust the autofocus smoothness, as a smoother transition could make this issue less noticeable. Another upgrade I'm hoping for in the next DJI Pocket 4. The specialized white balance sensor that DJI already introduced with the Osmo Action 4. Guys, white balancing is so easy with it, and the colors turn out just great. Okay, now you're telling me, if you shoot against the sun, you end up with burnt highlights. You're right. I did push it to show you, but I wanted you to be aware. Burnt highlights can occur. So, to wrap up all the tests, here's my overall verdict on the DJI Pocket 3. The video quality is spectacular for a gimbal camera, unmatched by any other. But you have to pay a steep price, one that might make you think twice or sacrifice something else due to its significance. Some aspects might not justify the hefty price tag, like the focus tracking that fails at a distance, occasional focus breathing, and some burnt highlights. And let's hope it doesn't overheat next summer. Will I keep it or send it back to Amazon? Flaws aside, it's still the best vlogging camera out there. So you can guess.